My name's Indigo. I'm a postdoctoral research fellow in the ARC Centre of Excellence for Automated Decision Making and Society at RMIT here in Melbourne. And I'm really delighted to be joining you all today representing the Australian Digital Inclusion Index team. The team is led by Distinguished Professor Julian Thomas and Distinguished Professor Joe Barraquette, in addition to Dr. Sharon Parkinson, who's the senior researcher on the team, and myself. Now, if for anyone who was in the earlier session today, starting at 1:30, my run-through is going to be quite similar. So I'm going to chuck a link in the chat to take you to our website, and I encourage you to have like a little search around and maybe zone out while you're listening to me talk about the same thing. But to give you a bit of structure around what I want to talk about today, is I want to talk briefly about our approach to digital inclusion and how we tackled the challenge of measuring it, and particularly how we've revised the index for this year and detailing the sorts of changes that we've made. I'm going to take a quick look at the key findings at a national level, and then talk through a couple of the opportunities that the new approach to the index presents that we're really excited about. And if we've got time, and if Laura's okay with this, I might try and quickly share my screen and give you a little bit of insight into the dashboards themselves. Alrighty, next slide, please. So when we think about digital inclusion, we're really talking about the capacity to access, afford, and have the skills to use the internet and digital technologies to support meaningful participation in everyday life. The index was developed to provide a robust evidence base for policy, for research, and for better practice in relation to moving towards a more digitally included Australia. We aim to measure digital inclusion at a national, state, and regional level view. And for those who are unfamiliar with the index, it basically gives everyone a score, an individual score from 0 to 100, 0 being the least digitally included, to 100 being the most digitally included. We aim to provide a geographic overview of digital inclusion, and we also aim to look at digital inclusion across time so that we can see what the key trends are to work towards improvement. In October of 2021, this year, we launched a revised index, and this has involved some significant changes to how we measure digital inclusion. This development is a new survey instrument which is dedicated and designed to deal with the increasing complexity and diversity of Australians' engagement with digital devices. It's called the Australian Internet Usage Survey, and we can talk a bit more about that in questions if that's of interest. We've used the same dimensions of access, affordability, and digital ability that we've always used, but we've updated the underlying components to make them more future-focused to try and accommodate the rapidly developing technologies that we're all using every day. And I suppose the key thing to know about the index redevelopment is that it does mark a distinct break between our old data up to the reports to 2020 and the new approach. We're dealing with a new set of questions, a new data set, so there is a break there. And because we knew that, this year we're reporting on two waves of data collection with this new model. So we've got 2020 and 2021 data, and we're sharing the data in a new way as well. So moving away from a quite static PDF report that was extremely long and not super exciting, we now have a set of interactive data dashboards that I've already mentioned, and I'm excited to show you today. Next slide, please. So as I say, we've got the index construction is based on three dimensions. When we're talking about access, we're talking about how often and through how many services and devices we're connecting to and using the internet. When we're talking about affordability, it's what does it cost to gain a good quality service with reliable connectivity. And when we're talking about digital ability, it's what we can do online and how confident we are in doing it. Next slide, thanks. So underneath each of the dimensions, we've got multiple components. When we're thinking about access, we're talking about the frequency and intensity of use, and we're ranging from no use at all to daily use. We're talking about connection type. So we're thinking about how people are connecting to the internet. What kind of infrastructures are they using? Do they have a fixed broadband or do they have a mobile-only connection? We're also considering the data allowance and speed that they've got access to. How much data do they have and what kind of bandwidth are they playing with? And finally, we're talking about the types of devices sensors that people have got access to. And we're now including devices like smart home devices and personal devices like smartwatches as well. The next slide, please. In the old index, we approached affordability as the actual spend within a household and the value of that expenditure. So how much they spent, what kind of value in terms of data they got per dollar. But as time has kind of gone on and the requirements of digital inclusion have changed, we've moved away from that approach, and we've thought about what it's required for a high quality, reliable connection to the internet that can enable the kinds of things that we need to do every day nowadays. As we all know, we're all working from home, we're all schooling from home. So what kind of connections do we need to allow that? And so on the slide there, we've got the kind of details of what we think an internet bundle that enables both quality and reliable connectivity might provide. And so then the question becomes, well, what proportion of people's income would be required to pay to access that type of internet bundle? And this is allowing us to sort of focus in on the differences across Australia's social landscape in terms of the capacity to pay for that. And I'll show you a little bit more about that shortly. Next slide. And the final dimension of the index is around digital ability. And so this is about how people use the internet and how confident they are in doing it. And we've now aligned our approach to an existing international project. It's called the Internet Skills Scale that comes out of research from the UK and the Netherlands. Van Dersen, Helsper and Einon, the fantastic world-leading digital inclusion researchers. And you can see the six components that we're focusing on there. So we've got basic, operational, advanced, information navigation, social, creative, and automation, which is getting into the use of those smart Internet of Things kinds of devices. Next slide, please. Okay, so that's how the index is kind of constructed. And now I want to talk quickly through the key findings. So at a national aggregate level, we can see that digital inclusion is improving. In 2020, the country rated a score of 67.5. It's increased by 3.6 points in the last year to 71.1. But what we do see is that there are ongoing differences in the results between capital cities and those in the regions. And while this is narrowing over time, it seems like, it's still a fairly significant divide. So regional areas in Australia score 67.4, which is 3.6 points lower than the national average, but 5.5 points lower than metropolitan areas, which is pretty significant. Next slide, thanks. So we can see the index improvements are across the dimensions each year, or over the last 2 years, we've gone up across each of the dimensions. I want to flag here that we've got quite high scores now for affordability, which has come out of that new approach that we've taken. And it reflects the fact that for many Australians, affordability of internet services is not a huge issue in some ways. So although we've got higher numbers for affordability, we think that there's a more meaningful way to look at this data. Next slide, please, Laura. Which is converting it into the percentage of household income that's required. So looking at this slide, we can see, so this is again talking about that internet bundle that I was talking about. So not necessarily what people are actually paying, but what percentage of household income would they have to pay to gain access to that reliable and quality connectivity? So 21% of the Australian population could afford that internet bundle with just 2% of their annual income. And we think that's pretty good. There's a bunch of international standards that say that's an okay amount of money to spend on your internet access. But a quarter of the Australian population would need to pay up to 10% of their household income to gain access to that same internet connectivity. And 14% would need to pay more than 10% to do so, which is really significant numbers. And something that we're trying to think through now is maybe we need to think about this as internet stress in the same way that we think about rent or mortgage stress. Next slide, please. So this slide is looking at the geographic distribution of digital inclusion. So we've already talked a little bit about that metro and regional gap that you can see is quite significant here. It's also clear that there are some significant differences in outcomes between different states. The ACT, for example, is doing quite well at 77 points. Tasmania is lagging a little bit behind at 66. But the other states are sort of more or less the same, which again points more to that metro-regional divide that we're talking about there. Next slide, please. Now, there is a huge amount of information on this slide, but the main thing is to look at the highs and lows. So we're looking here at the digital inclusion distribution across social and economic dynamics. And what we can see is that digital inclusion in Australia is distributed according to these socioeconomic indicators. How included you are depends a great deal on how old you are, how much money you earn, how educated you are, your employment status, and the kind of housing that you live in or the structure of your household. We can see very big gaps between higher income quintiles and lower income quintiles, for instance. And so what we're looking at is not an inclusive internet in Australia, but a really socially and geographically stratified internet. Next slide, please. One of the things that we're doing with the new approach to the index is taking a new approach to identifying highly excluded through to highly included Australians. So we've broken the population up into these four categories: highly excluded, excluded, included, and highly included. And highly excluded Australians are those who receive an index score of 45 or below, compared to the national average of over 71, which we consider to be included. And so these are people who are substantially excluded from the opportunities that are presented by participation online, and 11% of the country is in that category. This is down from 2020, so I think it was 14% in 2020 off the top of my head. So there's been some improvement there, and these improvements might reflect the circumstances of COVID. More people have moved online, but we still have a very substantial number of people in that group. We also have a large number of people who are mobile only. And while mobile only plans are increasing in sophistication and data allowances, they're often much more expensive than a fixed line connection. As I've already said, affordability is a massive issue. And while we are seeing that access is improving, the benefits of that access are not being evenly shared. Next slide, please. So the critical gaps when we're looking at the data so far are on the slides here. There's 15.9 points between somebody who's employed and somebody who's not in the labour force. It's 26 points between those in the lowest and highest income quintiles. 33 points between those in our 18 to 34-year-old age group and those who are 75 or over. And 25 points between those who have a degree and those who didn't finish secondary school. Now, as I've already said, this data is no longer backwards compatible with our previous reports, but these same patterns are things that we've been talking about for quite some time. And so we're really confident about the way that we're approaching the index from now. Laura, I might share my screen if that's all right. Cool.
Sounds good. I'll just stop sharing. And awesome.
Is that working?
Yeah, I can see it.
Cool. So this is our new website, and I just wanted to give you a quick insight into the interactive data dashboards that are key to the index's new development. So you can get to them through this little button here, explore the data, or through latest data, interactive data dashboards here. But in the interest of time, here's some I've prepared earlier. Basically, it takes you to this menu where we've got seven different dashboards. So we can look at the data through a number of different ways. We can go through the total index, we can look at it geographically, we can focus in on digital exclusion, we can talk about the three different dimensions, and then we've also got these extra questions about how Australians use the internet. So these are moving beyond the index itself and thinking through who's online and what they're doing with it. The quick thing that I want to run through is just how to use the dashboards. They all look something like this. We've got insights that we're talking about the things that we think are most important on each page. If you're ever confused, we have tips. We have notes explaining various things. And on tiles that need more information, we have little hover question marks that will tell you what's going on and if you have any questions. You can toggle things on and off to look at them. You can cut the data by social demographic groups that you're interested in. So we might want to look at education levels, and it changes the whole page to be focusing on education levels. And then you might want to filter that. It's having a little minute to look at just education levels in metropolitan areas. So now we're looking at digital inclusion scores by education level only in metropolitan regions. You can export the data as PDFs. It'll look exactly as what you can see here, or you can download it as an Excel document and do your own analysis there. As I say, they all look basically the same. I think affordability is my most favourite slide. Breaks it all down into those percentages of household income, and you can toggle between the different groups and see that 82% of income quintile 2 would have to pay up to 10% of their income. And understanding digital exclusion is also, I think, a really important page. So this tells us the percentages of excluded and highly excluded people and highly included and included Australians and what they're doing online, the proportion of those population groups in Australia over time, how concerned these groups are about internet access and reasons they don't connect to the internet more often. And again, we can filter all of these things and cut the data by different social demographic groups. So we're really excited about the possibilities that this presents, and we really look forward to hearing more about how you guys use it and run with the data. Alongside that, we're also now able to share the questionnaire and to partner with groups to work on bespoke digital inclusion projects. So we also welcome contact about that, but I have gone well over my time, so I will hand back.